CNN, in June 2011, Roy Moore suggested on a radio show that getting rid of constitutional amendments after the 10th would solve many issues in the way the U.S. government is structured. That would eliminate many problems, Moore said after one of the hosts of the Aroostook Watchmen suggested it. You know, people don't understand how some of these amendments have completely tried to wreck the form of government that our forefathers intended. Quote, Moore singled out the 17th Amendment, according to an audio file obtained by CNN's KFile, which calls for the direct election of U.S. senators. A complaint he mentioned on Sunday during an unrelated interview ahead of Tuesday's special Senate election in Alabama. Right parenthesis, he also took issue with the 14th Amendment, which was passed after the Civil War and guarantees citizenship, equal rights and protection under the law to former slaves, claiming it put undue restrictions on the states. Once again, the media is taking a discussion about the overall framework for the separation of powers as laid out in the Constitution to twist Roy Moore's position on specific issues, Moore campaign spokesman Brett Doster told KFile. Roy Moore does not now, nor has he ever favored limiting an individual's right to vote, and as a judge, he was noted for his fairness and for being a champion of civil rights. Quote, Friday will mark 226 years since the Bill of Rights, the first 10 amendments, was ratified. In the meantime, Congress and the states added 17 more, though one, the 21st, and another, the 18th. If you were to wipe them all off the books, the country would be fundamentally changed. We might have President Donald Trump and Vice President Hillary Clinton one weird side effect. Democratic Republican Thomas Jefferson finished second in the 1796 election to the Federalist John Adams. But because of the law then, Jefferson became Vice President. The amendment made sure, among other things, that running mates won and lost together. Slavery would not have been outlawed in 1865, when the presiding officer announced that the resolution was agreed to by yeas 119, nays 56, the enthusiasm of all present, save a few disappointed politicians, knew no bounds, and for several moments the scene was grand and impressive beyond description. No attempt was made to suppress the applause which came from all sides, everyone feeling that the occasion justified the fullest expression of approbation and joy. Quote, the states could freely make laws to undo core federal rights. No state shall make or enforce any law which shall abridge the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States, nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor deny to any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the laws. Race could be a legal bar to voting. The right of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States, or by any state on account of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. there'd be a very different fight over who's going to be the next senator from Alabama. The Senate of the United States shall be composed of two senators from each state, elected by the people thereof, for 6 years, and each senator shall have one vote. We're arguing over when to hold Inauguration Day. Every 4 years, the terms of the President and Vice President shall end at noon on the 20th day of January, and the terms of Senators and Representatives at noon on the 3rd day of January, of the years in which such terms would have ended, if this article had not been ratified, and the terms of their successors shall then begin. The people of Washington, D.C., would have even less representation in federal government. The district constituting the seat of government of the United States shall appoint, in such manner as the Congress may direct, a number of electors of President and Vice President equal to the whole number of Senators and Representatives in Congress to which the district would be entitled, if it were a state. People could be legally compelled to pay for the right to vote if banned with poll tax, which was initially created to wait for it make it easier to vote. You didn't need to own land, just be able to pay a modest tab.but, that changed over time, as the poll tax was used as an end run on the 15th Amendment, to restrict the franchise particularly down south. The amendment is now also used to argue against efforts to create de facto expenses or taxes, like mandating voter ID, and then charging people for the required document. Here's the text. The right of citizens of the United States to vote in any primary or other election for president or vice president, for electors for President or Vice President, or for Senator or Representative in Congress, shall not be denied or abridged by the United States, or any state by reason of failure to pay any poll tax or other tax. Quote, we'd have to debate, without any real guidance, about the line of presidential succession even weirder. The custom was established by John Tyler, who as vice president took over after the elected president, William Henry Harrison, died. The important part, for the time being, in case of the removal of the president from office, or of his death or resignation, the vice president shall become president. Quote, but American soldiers in combat might not be able to vote the right of citizens of the United States, who are 18 years of age or older, to vote or not be denied or abridged by the United States, or by any state on account of age.